The following contains strong language, violence, and nudity. It is intended only for mature audiences. Viewer discretion advised.
The following presentation is brought to you by The Realm Network.
I went to the movies the other day, so there's a new announcement in the movie theater mixed in with the trailers. Please pick up the garbage from around your seat after the movie. Oh, okay. Maybe I'll bring my orange jumpsuit and a wooden stick with a nail in it, too. In case I want to work my way down the highway after the credits. I'm not picking nothing up. I'm the one that threw it down. Why would I throw it down and then pick it up? There is an agreed upon deal between us and the movie theater people, whoever the hell they are. And that deal is understood by every single person in this room. The deal is, you're ripping us off. Okay? We get it. We're fine with it. A lot of overpriced, oversized crap we shouldn't be eating to begin with. Fine. It's all fine. In exchange for that, when I'm done with something, I open my hand. Right? Let it roll down 8 rows. Not sticking my arm down into that dark, scary hole. See if I can pry out 3 goobers that have been soda welded there since the Shawshank Redemption.
You're crazy, man. You're a loser.
Playoffs?
It's the Marc and Lowell Show.
The Marc and who?
Starring the meteorologist who does it for the viewers.
Smoke!
Lowell Melser.
Can you get out of here?
And the man who rides the coattails of his friends and family. Marc Ronick.
Hey, guys, listen up with the amplifier.
And now, here they are. Radio's equivalent of a dial-up connection.
Hello, boys.
Marc and Lowell.
Hello and welcome, everybody, to the Marc and Lowell Show. I am your host, Marc Ronick, and here with me, as always, my co-host, Lowell Melser. Hello, Lowell.
Good evening, my friend.
I haven't seen you and really haven't talked much to you since Christmas.
Yeah, we've been going back and forth. We were supposed to do a show and then...
Couldn't do a show.
And now could do a show, and now here we are.
Here we are, and of course we have Old Faithful. It's our good friend Lisa Runyon. Hello, Lisa.
Good old Faithful.
Good old Faithful, who has a homework assignment I just came up with just this minute for you. Your homework assignment is to start thinking about how you're going to say goodbye.
I already was.
Okay.
Oh, good.
Any regular listener knows that Lisa's been struggling with her goodbye, that she used to have her staple.
I actually didn't think about it prior to this moment, but I have some time now. It's in my mind.
But don't let it distract you.
Of course not.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. You know, I should say, out of the gate, so we just have Lisa here.
Yeah.
Just Lisa. It's just Lisa.
No.
Lisa.
As in, it's not a full house.
It's not a full house.
Okay. And I always look forward to the show even more when it's a full house, because I just love what everybody brings to the table. When it scales down to 2 or 3, sometimes I get a little more anxiety about the show.
Can I just tell you?
Feel more pressure.
I personally prefer the smaller cast because then I get to say more things.
Ah, that's true. That's true. It can be an overpowering group.
Very interesting.
Very interesting.
But
it would have been nice to have everybody, because I should tell you that today, well, not today, but we just passed a milestone for the Marc and Lowell Show. I'm not going to do a major buildup. It was actually on Reed's birthday, December 29th. It was the Marc and Lowell Show's 7th anniversary.
Wow.
How can that be?
2011. It was December 29th, 2011. Lowell and I recorded our first show together.
Wow. Marshmallow vodka.
Yeah, with lots of vodka.
Never forget. Never forget.
That's quite an episode. Drunken, inexperienced Marc on the microphone.
No clips, huh? You didn't have any clips?
Marc and Lowell. Rewind.
On our third show, I believe, Lowell, mm-hmm. we actually took some calls, and Tripp called in and was referencing how drunk I was. And he pointed out this word that I said particularly.
You know, what's funny is that I think I would have been able to enjoy it more and participate more.
Oh, that's participate. Yeah. That wasn't particularly. Here's particularly.
This group is a wild bunch. The women particularly are a wild bunch.
Yeah, that was no good. So what should we say? First Christmas, as I said, that was probably the last time I really spent some time with Lowell. And I got
actually spent Christmas at Lowell's house.
I did. Christmas Eve. We went there, mm-hmm. Amy and I, and spent Christmas Eve with Reed and the kids. I should really wait. You know, I completely forgot. And since Jonah's not here, we called Santa Claus.
Oh,
right. We called Santa.
Called Santa Claus.
Oh,
maybe,
wow.
Lowell, maybe what I'll do is that'll be the egg.
Oh, did you? Oh, yeah, record it.
You recorded it.
Are we keeping you up, sir?
Yeah, I had a couple of drinks tonight.
Oh.
I had a couple of glasses of wine because it's my Friday tonight.
Oh, me too. Nice. Me too.
Yeah, I had worked 9 days straight.
Ooh.
Oh.
Yeah.
But you did have some good time off, you and I both.
Yes, for sure.
But then it's just never easy going back to the grind.
It's never easy going back.
Nope.
Never.
Yeah, and you too, Lisa. You had some time off too as a teacher,
beautiful.
Of course.
It was beautiful.
All right. Well, people are probably wondering what happened. Any good stories at Lowell's house when Marc and Lowell are together? Mm-hmm. But we didn't have any other than that phone call. That was probably a big highlight as far as our listeners would be concerned. Mm-hmm. But otherwise, it was just like a nice family Christmas with a couple of Jewish guys.
Right.
Yeah, we really had a nice Christmas.
We did. The kids had a blast.
Right.
I mean, they were super excited, you know,
sure.
night before. And
well, I was going to say, too, I was actually very surprised the next morning, because you guys came over for Christmas Eve. The next morning, the kids actually slept till 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah, what? Yeah, yeah. We were very happy about that.
Yeah, like, we didn't come downstairs until a little bit after 8.
Yeah.
And I was like, that's great.
Especially for guests who don't like to get up at that crack of the dawn
right,
in the morning.
Exactly.
Right, right.
And man, that was quite a Christmas those kids got. A
lot of gifts.
They got lots of good stuff. All right, now some things are coming back to me because first there was, we discovered Christmas Eve through the evening. We discovered that Reed had found his Christmas present.
Oh, yeah, one of them. Yeah,
no.
One of them.
One of
yeah.
them. The big one, really.
Yeah, really.
Right?
The
That's
big
a pretty
one.
Big
yeah.
one. It was his bicycle, his new
oh,
bike.
Right.
The funny thing is that, I guess, Lowell, you could explain this better, but you and Allie already knew that he may have had an idea.
Yeah, because Sloane was running her mouth because she saw it first.
Because you had to put it together. Right?
I had to put it together.
Yeah.
And I was finishing putting it together, and Sloane came down and saw me putting it together, and then she had mentioned something to Reed, like, oh, Daddy was putting together your bike. Daddy, bike.
Yeah.
And I'm like, no, Sloane, what are you talking about?
Hey, what bike?
Crazy kids.
Hey, you must have been dreaming.
Yeah, that was a dream. So then, I guess, did he see it with you, or did
so
he?
So here's what happened.
Yeah.
Somehow, all of a sudden, I found myself in a game of hide-and-go-seek.
Right.
And I, you
which
know.
Which is the best,
it's,
by
it's
the
a
way.
Good game. It's definitely, it's always
yeah.
a good game, especially
yeah.
when you're outsmarting the
right.
5 and 3-year-old,
right,
you know?
Exactly.
Right.
Then it's really fun.
Exactly.
So, you know, but they first, you know, I had to kind of test the waters and first kind of hit in it, like, right behind a door in
right.
a bedroom. And
right.
Reed was, you know, he wasn't about that. He's like, come on, dude. I can,
right.
I can.
I'm a good seeker.
I'm a good
I'm
seeker.
I'm not 3.
Come on.
Yeah.
So I made it harder. So I went in the basement, found a place. But there was a point where we were running around together in the basement, and Reed goes, don't go in that room. And it was the storage room in the basement.
Right.
And at first I was like, okay, he's going to tell me like it's too scary or he's mm-hmm. scared, doesn't want to go. And he goes, there's a surprise in there.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay, what kind of surprise? There's a surprise. And he was like, He just kept dodging the question, so I just let it go. But later, I heard Allie talking with Amy and maybe Lowell, and just talking about that they think Reed was either snooping or had an idea or something.
And you were like, oh,
and I was
yeah,
like, oh,
does.
You know, he mentioned that room down there.
Yeah.
Then later, when I was playing hide and go seek, I hid in the basement. 20 minutes had gone by. The kids still hadn't found me.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, Amy is helping them now find where I am. And she takes them in the basement. And Reed says to Amy, don't go in that room. There's a bicycle in there.
Oh.
And I don't think he knew that he said that. You right. know, and then because he just kept going.
Right.
And then everything came together after that. He knew.
Yeah.
He knows. One way or another, he knew.
And he did eventually admit that he knew.
Yeah. So that had to be from mom and dad. Couldn't be from Santa, obviously.
Well, that was from Grams and Gramps.
No, but didn't you say okay. that Santa dropped it off early?
I did. I said Santa had dropped it off earlier because daddy had to put it together. Santa didn't have time to put it together.
Yeah.
So daddy had to put it together.
Got right.
It. Yeah.
But yeah, they were great. We had a blast with them, played with them a lot of Christmas morning and into the afternoon. And what's better than celebrating Christmas with little ones?
Kids. Yeah, yeah, because the magic is still there.
Because
yeah.
all our kids are right. teenagers, and Amy's kids don't celebrate Christmas.
Right.
And, yeah, so.
And Lisa's kids are all grown up.
My kids have four legs, and they'll do whatever I want
them right.
to do.
That's right. All right, well, I have to tell Lisa about this a little.
What? Oh, yeah.
This week, I was on our Twitter, Mandel Show, at Mandel Show. And I saw a listener had texted me, this was several days ago. He texted the show, or maybe he texted me personally, and he said, tweeted. And he said, hey, look what's on TV. Look what I'm watching right now. And it's the scene that Lowell and I, from the beginning, even way before this show, it's the scene where Luke Skywalker and gang are trapped in the trash compactor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's closing in on right. them. And we all know this scene. It goes a little something like this.
Come in, 3PO! 3PO! Where could he be?
Where could he be?
Where could he be?
For some reason, that just always makes us laugh. And Lowell, I feel like that actually didn't originate with you and I. That wasn't a thing that started with you and I.
No, we found it. No, we found it.
It wasn't something that you had in college or something like that with your buddies.
Yeah, that was just the Emperor. The where okay. could he be? You and I discovered that. Yeah.
Where could he be?
Yeah, for some reason, yeah. that was just, it makes us laugh. No reason.
Right. Yeah.
So, and so the guy sent a picture of that scene, and it had the closed captioning, and it said, where could he be?
Right.
Yeah.
So we tweeted back at him from the show and said, obviously this was a little strategic, right? Mm. So he says, hey, look what's on the magic box, and it's that picture. And I say, where could he be? That at Hamill himself, Marc Hamill, that line that he says always makes us laugh for some reason. Mm-hmm. And then I get a text from Lowell. Marc Hamill just tweeted us. Or no, he actually
liked the tweet. He liked the tweet.
Yes.
That
and
is so awesome.
We were like two kids in a candy store. I was, yeah.
yeah.
Marc Hamill just liked our tweet. And you know, there's always that chance you think when a celebrity likes or follows you, you think, well, maybe this is just the machine, right?
Right.
But, I mean, it's pretty well documented he does his own tweeting.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm pretty confident that he actually saw the Marc and Lowell show on
right.
Twitter.
Right.
And it was funny. And Lowell and I had a good, you know, little chuckle about it over text. And then later that night, I was just sitting thinking about it. And I texted him in this voice, of course, in my head.
Right.
Whoa. That's cool.
No, it was just funny. I was like, you need to go. Maybe you should text Marc Hamill.
Right.
Or, you know, send him a tweet.
Right.
And tell him, yeah, come on the Marc and Lowell show.
Yeah, come on our show.
Lowell's verified, you know.
Sure.
He's a celeb in his own way.
Go, hey, Marc, come on the show. Yeah. Crickets.
Yeah, so that was very...
Do you want to listen to my podcast?
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, thinking game, pancake.
And by the way, side note. Billy Joel just started following us on Twitter.
What?
Now that I think might be the machine.
How? Why?
Like
I followed
Billy Joel.
Marc and Lowell show. We followed him recently, and all of a sudden we got a follow.
Oh, does he follow everybody?
I don't know.
Check out his followers.
You know, Billy Joel's coming to Orioles.
That's why I happen to have followed him, because I heard he's coming to Baltimore this summer.
Yeah, to Camden Yards.
Yeah. Yeah.
Try and get some free tickets from here.
Yeah, from the
yeah.
We went to see him at M&T Bank Stadium a couple summers ago.
Yeah, and you were kind of thinking maybe it'll be the last time, but now he's still going.
Yeah, he's still going, man, and selling out these huge places.
Yep.
He's
so
crazy.
I'm guessing he's still pretty good then, huh?
Yeah, Madison Square Garden. He does it like once a month and sells it out every month.
He's still got it. He can hit all the notes. It's crazy. Yeah. It really is. Like, he's still got it.
Lowell, you have to tell me about this tweet that I saw you tweet out a day or two ago.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know what I'm going to ask you, really?
Yeah, I do.
Please don't reheat fish in the microwave at the office. Please.
Yeah.
Double please.
I would never do that.
Somebody microwaved fish in the office, and it was like, it was brutal.
Ooh.
And that was my passive-aggressive way of dealing with it.
And what kind of attention did it get?
Oh, my God. It got a lot of response on Twitter, for sure.
A lot of people just swapping stories?
Yeah, agreeing, swapping stories.
Yeah.
Saying, what's worse, that or burnt popcorn.
Right.
You know.
But meanwhile, did anything happen at work?
One person said, well, I was eating tuna and maybe it was me. I'm like, no, it wasn't you, because it was in the microwave cooking. So it wasn't you.
Tuna fish, like tuna salad, is a totally different kind of thing.
Smell. Yeah.
But also.
Tolerable.
Yeah.
Tolerable. But I know, and I don't understand it. And so many people are like, yeah, I do. I do that. I'm like, that is so rude.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sorry. Fish is one of those things that if you don't finish it at the restaurant or whatever, bye.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Bye.
I will, as a chef, like as a chef in my own kitchen, I often overcook because I take things for lunch and I do.
Sure.
I don't mind leftovers.
Right.
Fish is one I will not cook.
Yeah, who does that? And fish,
no.
And you can't. And reheating a piece of fish in the microwave or like shrimp or anything, it never tastes good.
It's like rubbery.
It's like rubbery. Yep. Mm-hmm. It's like not. Yeah.
Yeah. Nothing appealing about
nope.
it.
If you go to the restaurant or you make dinner and it's fish, and you don't finish it, either eat it cold the next day or bye-bye.
I also think that making tuna fish salad or doing stuff, preparing a fish dish at work, even if it's new fish, it's not the, you know, from the day before, it's an offensive smell. It feels like
the tuna.
It feels almost rude because you know you are stinking the joint up.
Yeah.
Right.
But you're doing it anyway because it's like I'm hungry.
Them. Fuck you.
Fuck
this
everyone
is my
else.
Life. Yeah.
You know, but it's really inconsiderate.
Right. It is.
Can you have the tuna fish for lunch on the weekends, maybe? If you have to prepare it at work.
Right. Like, we're prepared the night before
and bring
we're
it
in the morning.
Right. But don't make it here.
Yeah. I'm definitely with you on that.
Hey, here's the other one. Can we throw another one on that? Because this one kills me at my job. We all have lunch at the same time as teachers. We all have the same half an hour.
Right.
If you are going to bring a frozen meal for lunch that takes 12 minutes in the microwave.
Right.
Oh.
Seriously?
That's
do you really need
rude.
The 12 minute cooking lasagna? Yeah, I don't
That's
think you do.
That's no fair.
I don't think you do.
Yeah,
and
you got to think about your...
I'm slightly exaggerating, but it is 8 minutes. 8 minutes is the time.
That's
and it's
still
just like,
of
a 30-minute lunch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's almost a third of the time.
Right?
That's not fair.
That's just so rude, too.
Yeah, that's not
like,
cool.
Really?
Asshole.
I guess I'll just have my taco meat just cold today, I guess.
Cold taco meat. Hey, listen, cold taco meat's not so bad.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's what Marc and Lowell are into... This week.
All right.
Hmm.
I think we should just jump right to it because I know you're into this.
What?
But I know it comes at a price.
Okay.
Lowell got himself a new toy.
Oh, yes,
ooh,
I did.
What kind of toy?
And I unfortunately didn't get to see it.
Yeah,
I could have
delivered it in time.
It could have been delivered in time. And that's kind of the theme of this story.
Oh.
Right? So, Lowell.
Yeah.
Tell everybody what you got.
So I got a shuffle bowling machine.
This is like,
what year
is it from?
1986. It's a tic-tac strike.
Okay.
I can send you the picture.
Well, yeah, I know. You sent it to me. I have it.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
So it's a tic-tac strike. It's a 1986 Williams machine that was in the arcade.
Yep.
So before Christmas... I had heard about in one of the warehouse centers around here, there's a guy that his main business is he supplies the skill cranes and the video games and stuff to movie theaters around the area.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So he puts them in the movie theaters and stuff and like they get 25% and he gets 75%.
Okay.
And then he just like
nice little
switches
deal.
Them out.
Mm-hmm.
But on the side, he refurbishes old games and has like new pinball games, and they have a lot of those like stand up ones with, you know, 60 different arcade games that we love, you know, from the 80s.
Yeah.
So I said to Reed, I wonder if they have a bowling machine. So then he got all excited to go play pinball and all that because he'd never played pinball before. We went, we looked around, and he had two of the bowling machines, and I was like, holy shit.
Yeah, I mean, you've been wanting this for years.
For years, I've wanted one. Because I remember, and what's funny is, remember, your dad had a pinball, a real pinball machine in your basement.
Space Invaders.
Yeah, and I always loved that, and I always wished that my dad would get a real pinball machine.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
But they never did.
They never did. Although, let's give your dad some props. A little bit later, he did make that basement into a movie theater.
Yeah, he did make it into a movie theater,
which is pretty kick-ass.
The pinball machine.
Minus the pinball machine,
and I was already in my 30s. Already in my 30s. So, you know.
right.
But anyway, yeah, the movie theater was awesome.
I remember as a kid when you went to somebody's house and they had like a pinball machine or like something really cool like that.
Yeah, like an arcade game.
It really stood out in your head, you know?
Definitely. Like, oh my God, for sure. I remember I'd go over there and Marc would kind of be, because I guess the luster had worn off for Marc, obviously, because he has it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, let's play. And Mark's like, all right, yeah, we can play.
Yeah, because you know what? Think about, take that excitement and enthusiasm that you had when you would come over.
Yeah.
I had that for like the first 2 weeks I had it.
Right.
You can't keep that excitement up for more than two weeks.
Right.
You're done after that.
Because I'm wondering if that's going to happen with Reed, because every day he wants to come down here and play bowling. Like we've played every single night.
I mean, that is a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, that's pretty awesome. You've been wanting it forever, and now your son wants to play it with you.
Yeah, well, here's the problem with good old Reedy.
Yeah.
He's not a good sport right now.
I know.
He's It's
the age.
Well, it's tough because, like, all right, when he loses, he, like, has a fit.
Right, I've seen it.
He mopes and whines and and starts crying a little bit, like, when he loses.
Right.
To me.
And he can't shake it.
Right. So then I pull back a little. I'm trying to teach him that you can't win every game.
Right,
exactly.
Right,
this is good.
Important.
This is good stuff.
Right. So some games I like blow him away and I'm like, Reed, it's not your day. And then he gets pissed.
And you're having a blast deep down.
Right. But then, you know, I'll pull back and legitimately a couple of times he's gotten lucky and gotten some very high points in some of the games we played and actually beat me. But most of the time, I'll pull back so he can catch up and then eventually beat me.
Mm-hmm.
But then when he wins, he like rubs it in my face that he's won. You're not good. You're not good. You're not good.
But do you do that to him? Do you do that to him?
No.
Okay.
No, he's too young for me to talk smack to him. I said, I'm Reedy up. This wasn't your game. Looks like I'm going to win.
But, okay,
and
so
then
listen.
Throws a fit.
Let's play off of this a little bit because this is excellent parenting, what you're doing with him, teaching him you can't win them all, right?
Right.
But
right.
Maybe one of those lessons is that you are the asshole, cocky winner and you do rub it in his face and then you tell him and then you say,
doesn't feel
do
good,
you like
does
this,
it?
Reed? How does this feel?
Yeah.
You did this to me. You remember when you did this to me? How do you feel right now? You know, you really.
That's part of the lesson.
Make him connect with that.
Right. And then he'll just go, meh.
Right.
Meh,
I know.
Meh.
But you know, somewhere that will
it's
be registered.
Reaching in.
Yeah. You got to do it more and more. But
I've almost done that a little bit where, like, when he starts to, I'll be like, wow, Reed, really?
Yeah.
You're getting a little spicy there?
Well, look, just like every kid on Christmas, especially at 5 years old, Reed was, you know, in my opinion, overwhelmed because he had so many choices in front of him after he opened everything up, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you know, he wanted to play with this, and he wanted to play this, and he wanted, Daddy, do the Legos. Daddy, do this Legos.
Right.
Uncle Marc, do this Lego. Do this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And when you don't, then he pouts and he's pissed off.
Yeah.
But every kid will do that. But Lowell, man, Lowell, like, had it by, you know, 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Lowell's like, huh, we shouldn't have gotten him anything for Christmas.
Right. Because it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
If he's going to cry, if he's going to cry and pout,
right,
then he'd have the same reaction if we didn't get him anything.
Right, and I'd keep all that money.
Right. Legos ain't cheap.
Because like he was, yeah, it was overload. Like he was just like,
yeah,
we built like 3 Legos already, and I'm like, all right, I need a break. And he's like, no, we got to build more. We got to build more. I'm like, no.
Here's the question.
And then mad.
Doesn't that speak then to a better system being the 8 nights? Because then you can just spread it out.
Yeah, Hanukkah, baby.
Yeah, right. I don't know. He's got too many gifts. So wait, so anyway.
Yeah.
Back to the bowling machine. So then I was faced with this dilemma. Like, it was like, all right, the ball's in my court. Do I want to get it? And I told him I'd think about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so then I thought about it for a week, and I talked to Allie about it. And we said, all right, let's get it. So then I said, all right, we'll order it. We'll get it. And then they had scheduled to deliver it on the Friday before Christmas.
21st.
Right, which is why I was saying I could have played with it.
Right.
But it like rained, and they will not deliver it in the rain.
And do they explain why?
Because they don't want to get the alley wet. Mm. If you get the alley wet, you're screwed.
I think there's technology out there that might be able to
you could
repel
wrap it.
The water.
Right. So that was their excuse.
I don't understand
that.
And then it rained,
right?
And then it rained.
It rained like
seriously.
And then it rained.
They scheduled a second delivery.
Uh huh.
It rained again.
Well,
scheduled
it rained
a third
for like
delivery.
3 weeks
yep.
Here.
Third delivery. It rained again.
Yeah.
And then I was getting pissed.
You're like, maybe I shouldn't get it.
Right. I almost was like, you know what?
Yeah.
I think maybe I'm just going to cancel this and forget it. Maybe it's not meant to be.
I know the 10 stages of Lowell anger.
Yeah.
And he was probably by the third attempt. Was probably at a good 8 or a 9. And that's the point where he's like, maybe I should just get my money back and forget the whole thing.
Honest to God, think about it. Each time, do you have to take off work each time they plan to deliver?
No, because 2 of the 3 deliveries, I was off from work.
Okay.
The third one, I wouldn't have been there, but Allie's home.
Okay. Right.
She's federal worker. They're all furloughed, so she's home.
Yeah.
But the other part of this, though, is that the guy who does the delivery is like a third party.
Mm-hmm.
He's a specialized mover in moving amusements.
Oh, okay.
There was special equipment that they needed to get this into the basement because it's while it's sturdy, it's fragile. Like, it's in different pieces. They break it apart to get it into the house.
Mm-hmm.
They needed, like, a special hydraulic unit to, like, get it down the stairs safely.
Yeah.
And he's got all
that
stuff.
I mean, this is a huge, huge piece of equipment.
Yeah, it's, like it's 9 feet long.
Yeah.
But he had all this special equipment to do that, and he had to bring his like pickup truck around the back of my house to the stairs to get it down. And once he delivered it, finally, I saw like, oh, I guess this is why they needed all this. Because they had to like, he put down like plywood on the ground, and like they had all this stuff out on the grass that like, and I was like, all right, yeah, if it was raining, I get it. This would not be
good
to do in the
rain. Yeah. Especially your lawn.
So, he had like a whole thing set up to get this done properly.
Right. And it would destroy your lawn.
Right.
It was good as done in the winter. Because if it was done in the summer, maybe they would have. But the thing that just was getting on my nerves was like, so we had scheduled these days, and then I would call him and be like, hey, are you guys going to come today? I know it's raining a little bit. And he's like, oh, I'm in Richmond today, so and it's raining, so we'll reschedule. And I'm like,
why are
the hell are you doing? what's going on here? And then I called the guy at the amusement place, and I'm like, what's going on with this guy? Like, he won't call me, and then I call him, and then he tells me he's in Richmond, and I thought we were going to do the delivery today, and the guy at the amusement place says, I've used this guy a lot. He's good, And like,
weird.
Because most of the time, people just go and pick these things up, but this thing's too big to.
Yeah, there's no way you're picking that up.
Yeah. So, P.S., long story wrapping up here. Finally, he calls me and says, all right, we're going to come deliver it on. It was like several days after New Year's.
Okay.
And it didn't rain, and they brought it over, and it was fine.
Good. And now you guys are playing it every day.
Every day, yeah.
Do you love it?
Yeah, I love it. I love it. It's great. It's so much fun. And, I was like asking about maintenance, and I'm like, I got 2 kids, they'll throw it hard, this and that. They're like, these things are made to be in bars and abused.
Yeah.
They're like, home use, it's like,
yeah,
don't worry at all. You're not going to break it. I'm like, all right.
And we should say, honorable mention, and since we're talking about old arcade type games, we should, for the Into this week, give, even though it's maybe not this week, but we are definitely, Lowell and I both are into Wreck-It Ralph 2.
Oh, did you see it?
Amy and I took Haley and Matthew, and we went and saw it, and we all loved it.
Did Haley and Matthew love it?
We all loved it.
Did you guys all see the first one?
Yes, and I liked it.
Oh, yeah.
I personally liked it better than the first one.
I think I did, too, yeah. But like they watch the first one sometimes, mm-hmm. and I always like watching it.
Oh, yeah, so it's a good movie, but
I've never seen it.
The second one, it's great because what it's doing is it's mashing up. You know, it's our pop culture and our kids' pop cultures coming
combining,
together.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's the old arcade games and it's the internet.
Yes.
Right.
And it's all colliding in a humorous, clever Disney kind of way. You know what I mean?
The princesses part was so funny, right?
Disney princesses definitely stole
video
the
games,
show.
Though, so, like, what's.
No, but Lisa, see, this is where you would because the video game references are all the stuff that we knew as kids.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's all mainly.
Pac-Man,
yeah, it's
Donkey
all that
Kong.
Kind of stuff.
Okay.
eBay takes center stage too, which
yes.
I thought was kind of funny.
Yes,
yeah.
eBay. There's a little, you know, some Amazon stuff in there,
yeah.
but eBay is definitely a big part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, eBay's a big part, and they make I don't know what's it's a I guess that social media thing they used was fake, but
yeah, they couldn't use YouTube for I guess YouTube wasn't.
Oh, they did use Twitter.
Yes, they did.
They did use Twitter,
but it was very well done, very clever.
Yeah,
definitely recommend it. I will tell you what I don't recommend. We tried out one of our movie theaters nearby, kind of revamped.
They put in the good seats?
They put in the great seats. We love that. The reclining, the automatic reclining, mm-hmm. big comfy seats, right?
Is it you get your seat in advance?
Get your seat
too?
In advance, yep.
I think that's great.
Me too.
It's brilliant.
What I was also excited about is they added a new feature.
Hmm.
Okay, first time I was ever going to try it. It was at your seat delivery.
Oh.
So we got there just, you know, like maybe 5 minutes before the previews started. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we didn't know what to do, how it worked or anything.
Right.
So we got some direction. We had to go to the counter to place the order.
Mm-hmm.
We place our order. There are some foods you get and take with you to go to the seat, like candy. I think popcorn and
yeah.
your drinks, that kind of the basics, right? But if you start ordering their extended menu, whether it's hot pretzels or chicken tenders or, you know, they had a whole plethora of different you know, fancy for movie theater items. So we picked what we wanted and I got the pretzels and I think another hot food item. I can't remember. But the point is, there is a problem with this kind of service when you're going to a fucking movie.
Yeah.
Especially if you get there right before the previews. Because you're sitting in your seat, and you kind of want your food, for one.
Right.
But two,
yeah,
you're waiting for your food, okay? And you're like, one preview goes by, two previews go by, and then you're like, oh, this is a relatively new and still popular movie, so I know I can still wait through some of these previews. My food will be here before the movie starts.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it's not there when the movie starts.
Right.
So now the movie's started. So the problem is you're sitting there trying to focus on the movie, but all you keep thinking is, eventually my food is going to come here, and I'm going to get pulled out of my movie experience. I got to deal with that. I'm going to miss something in the movie.
Right.
Right.
And so then you can't focus.
And you're also saying to yourself, when's my food going to get
That's
here?
That's the thing. You can't
right.
you can't focus on the movie because you keep thinking the food. And then
yeah.
you see a little movement in the corner of your eye, and you're like, oh, there uh-huh. they come. And then they're not there.
Nope.
So how do they know where to find you?
You tell them when you're...
The ticket.
Because of the assigned
yeah, seats.
Right.
You tell them where you're sitting. And then they
so then
bring your
you
order.
So then why do you worry about it? Just let them bring your food.
Because then that's
you don't have
the
to
next.
Pay for it, do you?
That's the next.
How
problem.
Long did it take? How far into the movie did it take?
We were probably. We were honestly probably about 20 minutes into the movie.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, can I give you our food experience?
Yes,
wait,
but
wait.
Let me. Yes.
All
yes.
Right,
but
okay.
Here's,
yeah, yeah.
here's the thing.
Yeah.
No, it does not cost extra for the delivery, of course, but it does cost extra because I think, oh, man, I wish I could remember these prices. Lowell. They were. Absurd. I mean, we're talking
right?
like we're talking now like stadium prices, like going
right.
to a NFL Ugh. Football game.
Right.
That must be where they make all their money.
I wish I could remember what freaking item. I think I got like a thing of like soft hot pretzels or something like that, and it was like $15 or chicken
right.
oh my
chicken
God.
Tenders,
$15
or something
yeah,
like
I'm
that.
Sure.
Yeah, it was really obscene,
ridiculous.
But here, but that's the problem. So waiting 20 plus minutes for your food at the movie theater that, you know, they're cooking and serving right there. Right. Cooking, I use loosely.
Right. Yeah, cooking.
So, you know, there's no excuse for it to take that long, really.
No.
But, okay, fine, it takes long, whatever. But then it pulls you out of the movie. Mm-hmm. You have to stop and remember, especially when you're with four people.
Right.
Because they're coming in. One guy is coming in. Hey, guys, I got my tray of food for you.
Who's got the hot dog?
And you're embarrassed because he's, you know, not only distracting us now, he's bothering other people because he's also standing right in the middle, you know, in front of people. All right, here's your popcorn. And you get all this food and then you're sorting it out. Oh, this isn't mine. Oh, here, switch this. And then you miss like, you know, a few minutes of the movie. And then you feel, thankfully, we're talking about Wreck-It Ralph 2.
Right.
So, you know, if I miss a little something, it's not going to kill me here.
Right.
But I do, when I go, even Matthew, my stepson, when we were leaving for the movie, he said, I love going to the movies with Marc because he makes it such an experience. It's because I love going to the movies. It's like a big thing for me. So to pull me out of it, even for 2 minutes, pisses me off.
Right.
How do you feel when you have to go to the bathroom in the movies?
I hate that so much.
If the movie's too long, you got to watch it. You got to watch how much you drink.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But that's why you got to be careful with the popcorn, too, because if you eat all the popcorn, then you get more thirsty because of the salt, and then it's all off.
Yeah.
But see, that's your problem, because you don't go to the movies and, you know, wait for them to bring you chicken tenders. You, like, get popcorn and candy.
True. But yeah, I'm wondering if that delivery thing is not such a good idea.
It's not. It is not. I do
but
not
I
recommend it, and I think
it's stupid.
If
someone was standing in front of me serving food, and I'm like, get the fuck out of my way. I paid for this movie.
Right. That's why. It's just, I think there's a flaw in the system. I think what they should do is have a cutoff when you can order that service.
Exactly. That's,
you know, from before the movie starts.
And we'll bring it to you, but you're sitting
but
in
at
your
some point.
You know,
or,
you know what would be a better way to.
You're going to beat me to it.
Yeah, go ahead.
It's going to be like a send a text to your phone, your food is ready, or something like that.
Yeah, or I was going to say, you could order it in advance, and then, like, do you ever use, like, the Dunkin' Donuts app or anything
the time.
And pick it up at the place?
All the time.
So you notice the Dunkin' Donuts app, it's like you order it, and then it's like, hit here when you're going to come and pick it up.
Yeah.
You hit the button when you know you're going to go pick it up.
Yeah, click here when you're ready to pick up your order. Yeah.
Right. So that's what it should be. It should be, you should order it in advance, and then it's like, hit this when you get to your seat, you know?
Yes, and you know what? Look, I'll say it. It's AMC movie theaters, okay? So if you have the app, you'll see it. Some of those theaters that do delivery offer that option, the order in advance option.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But for some reason, maybe because it's a new feature added at this particular theater, it ain't available to do that right now.
Right.
So that's the problem. And that's the solution.
My food experience was awful. I told you this, right?
You
I don't know.
Always have the phone. Worst.
Well, all right. So luckily, my wife is very smart.
Yeah.
And she says to me, why don't you bring some snacks to the movies?
Okay.
And I said, all right, that's a good idea. So I had this little carrying thing, and I'm like, they're not going to bother me with this because I'm with a little kid. I could just say it's his insulin or something.
Right.
You know, like,
right.
You know, like it's a pack with like cold stuff.
I like how you pick the excuse that you know they're not going to give you a hard time about.
You're not going to give you a hard time about.
Yeah.
So we packed water, and I packed myself like a, you know, a diet cherry Coke. Mm-hmm. And then I brought like some carrots and hummus. Reed had this pack of Skittles that he wanted to bring that he got from school.
And this is all
so
fitting in your
stuff.
This is all fitting in your fanny pack?
Yeah, my
is insulin sack.
It's like a little lunchbox. It looks like a lunch.
Okay.
It's like an adult lunchbox.
Okay.
So, and then I said to Reed, I said, all right, and when we get to the theater, I said, I'm going to get some soft pretzels with cheese, and you want to get popcorn, right? And he's like, yeah, we'll do that. And I was like, okay.
My man, soft pretzels and cheese.
Yep, that's the best.
The best.
So then we get there 10 minutes before the movie starts, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the line for the food was like the TSA line at Thanksgiving travel.
Yeah.
It was filled wrap around like the maze, fully filled wrapped around maze,
no popcorn,
coming out.
No soft pretzels.
Coming out almost to the exit to leave the theater.
No.
Like, or when you walk in.
I would not be in that line. There's no way.
And I'm like, oh my God. And I'm like, oh my God. Oh my God. I'm like, all right, let's get in line. And I get in line, and we're standing there It's 10 minutes, and now it's 1 o'clock when the movie's supposed to start. And I'm like, I know they're going to show at least like 5 or 6 previews, which they ended up showing like 8 or 9.
Right, I know.
But I finally said to Reed, I said, hey, man, I don't know if this is going to, because we hadn't really even budged in like 10 minutes. I'm like, how are these people going to see their movie?
I know.
It's like, it's ridiculous. And we had to bail.
Wow.
Yeah.
Thankfully, he wasn't pissed, because I think he was so excited to be at the movie theater, and he wasn't pissed.
Yeah.
But I was kind of pissed, because, you know, I wanted my soft pretzels with Chee.
Yeah, I hear you. I hear you. That's like one of the, you know, because, you know, I've been trying for the past year now to eat better.
Yeah.
And we talk about food like we don't give a shit about eating healthy, but,
right.
And, you know, we do have our cheats, but I don't have many, but the movie theater is always a cheat for me. Like, I always want, and if they don't have it, I'm disappointed. I want my Slurpee.
Yeah.
And I want my hot pretzels with Chee.
Yeah, hot pretzels with Chee is like, man, I wish we had that when we were kids going to the movies. It was really just popcorn and candy when we were kids.
Right, right.
And then I remember that once in a while, some place would break out, like, that you started seeing, like, nachos or stuff like that.
I think that's why I am still, like, a popcorn candy girl, because it's like what I grew up with, and it's my jam.
Yeah.
I've been to some theaters, and stupid me, I thought maybe there was a slight chance this would happen. So they have the main concession area, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then when you go past when the guy scans your phone for the tickets, when you go into the area, sometimes they have like kiosks where they have like people just selling popcorn or just selling candy, like for overflow, because there's so many people, like, just specialty. It's like, you want a popcorn or do you want like M&M? Like,
wait, this
specific.
Is your idea, or this is at a theater you go to?
No, I've been to, when I've gone to movie theaters before that are really crowded, that's what they've had.
That's a
I thought on an off chance, like, it's very specific. It's either popcorn or like a couple of candies.
But what about this? What about this?
Yeah.
What about those people that get to the theater at an early, reasonable time that are in their seats? You have a guy or girl walking around with a cart.
Right.
There you go.
Right.
Like at a ball game.
They're missing out on all these money opportunities here.
The simple cart. You know, it would have, you know, all the candy.
Simple.
All the candy you could have, right?
Right.
I mean, you could have one of those carts that's got like the cooler, and then you could offer some ice cream or something too. But even if you want to keep it simple, you have popped popcorn, you have some drinks, and you got your candy. And
you got that card reader.
And
slider.
Then you'll reduce the lines for the more complicated people.
Right.
And then all the easy people, they're just sitting in their seats enjoying their food.
Right. Bring it
to because
me.
I guarantee you the majority of people either want popcorn or they want candy. Or they either want popcorn or M&Ms or Twizzlers or Milk Duds. Like, that's all they want. They don't want all the specialty crap.
It is such a ripoff. I mean, it is such a ripoff. It's like $9,
frankly,
I think, for a large popcorn.
Yeah.
$9. I mean, what is that? Like 500% profit or something?
Yeah. Easily.
Dude, for real, if you just want candy, go to Five Below.
For real.
Yeah. Amy likes to do that.
Seriously.
But I don't know what it is. I think, you know, half the time I'm last minute about my movie ticket, so then I don't have time to make a stop. Or I just don't think about it until last minute and I don't have time. So, but that is, Amy always wants to do that.
It's smart.
Seriously, you get a bigger box of candy at Five Below for a fucking dollar.
Right.
That a smaller box of the same candy at the movie theater is $5 or $6.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's insane.
Quick now, we got to go rapid fire here as we wrap up. But I just need to say, you are looking at the Marc and Lowell Show Fantasy Football League champion.
You said that last time.
I told you that at Christmas.
Oh.
Congratulations.
I see it's all blending together. Madden.
Yes. So, I'm very, very happy. It's been a while since I've had a fantasy football championship. So,
Mazel.
Yeehaw. Man, dude, I had so many things to do, but you know what? It'll be good to save a lot of these with the rest of the crew, too, to have around here. Mm-hmm. But I do want to do this because it's going to get old. We all remember
Lowell.
What did you hear?
Lowell.
I heard Lowell. What did you?
Lowell.
Okay, we all heard Lowell. I was doing show prep and Amy was in the room. She was hearing Yanny the whole time.
So
I was hearing
funny.
Lowell.
Well, I told you how I did hear Yanny that time.
Yeah,
right?
yeah, you did.
Right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
You ended up hearing it like through a phone in the bathroom.
In the bathroom. Yeah,
yes.
I was in a closed space.
Now, did you guys hear the Grover F-bomb.
Yes.
No.
All right, everybody knows.
I didn't hear it.
Everybody knows good old Grover from Sesame Street. Right.
Yeah.
This, obviously, we should say up front, obviously, everybody knows he didn't drop the F-bomb on Sesame Street, okay?
Right.
But there is a scene that I will play for you here where Grover is very excited about an idea whoever he's with, his buddy, has. And to me, it sounds like he's dropping the F-bomb.
It really
and
does.
And every time I play it, I hear that.
I hear it, too.
And again, Amy heard something different. Here it is.
Move it to follow you.
Move the camera! Yes! Yes, that sounds like an excellent idea!
What did you hear?
No, do it again.
Yes, that sounds like an excellent idea!
Yes, that sounds like an excellent idea.
Yes, that sounds like an excellent idea!
And when you say
when
it,
you say it I
then
hear
I
it.
Hear it. But all the time... Oh, we don't have to bleep.
What are you hearing him say?
All the time I hear
Seriously?
Him saying,
oh, that's a fucking excellent idea.
Fucking excellent
Wait,
idea.
Wait, play it again. Let me see if I can imagine that.
Okay, think of it again. Oh, that's a fucking excellent idea.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a fucking excellent idea.
I see where it could sound like that.
Yes, that's a fucking excellent idea.
And that's how
idea.
Amy was responding too. She's like, yeah, I hear it. But and I'm like, no, it
no,
is
no,
crystal
it sounds,
clear.
Yeah, it sounds,
no, it's not crystal
it
clear.
It is.
Yes, that sounds like an excellent idea.
I mean,
that sounds like an excellent idea.
That sounds like a fucking excellent idea is what it sounds like.
It sounds like an excellent idea.
No.
I'm telling you, really.
I'm not hearing it. I'm with Amy on this one.
I would love to hear what everybody else thinks.
Yes.
I almost had a disaster over here and almost spilled water everywhere,
oh,
all over the electrical
all on your equipment.
All
huh?
on the equipment.
New computer.
Yeah. Woo doggy.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave you with this one.
Yeah.
Because we teased it on social media. We couldn't get to it today because Jonah couldn't be here today.
Shameful.
I know. But here's the thing. You can't get mad at him because he's with his wife right now, who is now in her third trimester. Mm-hmm. And they are on that. You know this stuff, lol. They're on that tour the hospital thing that you do when you're pregnant for the first time.
Yeah.
So, yeah, how can you get mad at him? But... it is really highly disappointing to us because if you were listening to the last episode, you may have heard us talking about all these lost tapes or these old tapes that we made as kids. And there was one in particular. No, everybody, we don't have this one.
Yeah.
But there was that one that where Jonah was speaking with a strange accent, let's just say.
Yeah, strange accent.
Throughout the entire tape.
We gotta find that tape.
But and then Jonah had reminded me that once when we were in college, he thought he might be a good voiceover guy. And I was an intern at WJFK, so one weekend we went in there, went into one of the sound booths, and recorded a bunch of stuff. No, he didn't find that.
Mm.
But
yeah.
He did find a cassette tape of what they call the Lowell and Jonah show. I'm sorry? Let me take it back. The Jonah and Lowell show.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, always second.
Wow.
Yeah.
What I will do for you, Lowell, is I will give you a little teaser.
Okay.
As we wrap up.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I have high voice.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I haven't gone through puberty yet. I think I was like maybe 11 or 12.
So, ladies and gentlemen, here is the intro to the Jonah and Lowell show. That's Jonah.
I know.
From Hollywood, it's the Jonah and Lowell show, starring Jonah Berger and Lowell Meltzer. And now, here's Jonah and Lowell.
I had so much fun with this tape. It is a little mining for gold because, you know, some of it,
it's painful.
The show, our listeners will not laugh at.
Right.
Yeah.
Us, we will all laugh at it probably.
But if we laugh, then people will laugh.
Yes, that's true. I mean, for us, our diehard listeners, I'm sure, would laugh along with us. But there is plenty of gold for everybody to hear. But I will say, if you remember, look, you hear it in the intro of the Marc and Lowell show all the time.
Hey, guys, it's enough with the amplifier.
Yeah.
Now, that is my dad yelling at Lowell and I. Well, it's a simulation because we lost the original tape. But that is my dad redoing him yelling at us when we were recording our own video and stopped us right in the middle of our brilliant Oscar award-winning scene that we were doing.
Play it again.
Hey guys, it's enough with the amplifier.
I'll never forget that.
I know, me neither.
I mean, it sticks in my mind like it happened yesterday.
Hey guys, it's enough with the amplifier.
Sitting there.
You were sitting Indian. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you can't.
Sitting there.
Crisscross applesauce.
Crisscross applesauce. Yeah. Sorry, just a habit from my right. childhood days, right. I swear to God. Yeah. And you were singing operatically the theme to the original Star Trek.
Yeah, it was the end. It was the end. And you, while you were taking the camera.
And I was zooming
and
in.
And zooming in on my crotch.
Yes, that's right.
In the video.
And halfway through that, as you're going, oh.
Hey guys, it's enough with the amplifier.
But Lowell, did you know that you had that same moment when you were doing your tape with Jonah?
Yeah, we had another, but I don't think you can hear his parents.
I'm
though,
glad you said so. No, you can't unless you are experiencing the magic of the Marc and Lowell show.
Ah.
I was driving in my car from Frederick, Maryland. I was listening to my country radio when I heard. What? Sorry.
Because you're right. I tried to boost that audio as loud as I could.
Couldn't hear it, huh?
Not even a little inkling of his parents or yours, whoever's
Can't
house.
Can't even hear it.
Yeah.
That's a famous line, by the way. I was driving in my car.
I know it was.
Frederick, Maryland.
In my car from Frederick, Maryland. I was listening to my country radio when I heard.
When I.
What? Sorry.
Because there was a long gap in between both of us. So
you
know,
being really loud and your sister's trying to take a nap right now.
Right. It was something like that because it was a long gap.
It was late night. It was late night. We were like, we recorded this like all night.
Oh my God. And I will tell everybody, the big tease is you ain't heard nothing yet because you get a lengthy, I will give people snippets because it is too lengthy, but a lengthy Jonah and Lowell Ramblewood rap.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah.
With plenty of beatboxing.
Right.
Ooh.
Terrible.
Yeah, terrible beatboxing. Doesn't even come close to yours. But I don't, it was Jonah doing all the beatboxing.
Yes, yes.
But, and I think much like, I could be wrong, but I feel like much like in our rap.
Yeah.
I was kind of trying to end it eventually, and like,
because you knew it was going
Jonah
on too long.
Jonah didn't want to end it. Yeah, and Jonah didn't want to end it. And much like you, you didn't want to end it either.
Right. Because, you know, eventually there's got to be some gold somewhere.
You're fighting to continue.
Yeah,
and
there's going to be something funny, I promise.
Like, I'm like, we've been doing this rap for like 15 minutes. We got, all right, it's the Ramblewood rap's coming to an
end. Yes, yes, yes. But I will, and I'll give you a little tease, Lowell.
Hmm.
There's also, I think actually I may have texted you about this, but there's also another show that is hosted by Jonah. It is from the morning radio shows that we all used to do here and there at our camp.
Oh, a camp.
So in the morning, you would wake up to
somebody's voice.
Jonah or Lowell or me and Lowell or whatever. You'd hear counselors doing their own little morning zoo type show to wake up the camp.
Mm-hmm. I feel like I've seen that in like camp movies, too.
Marc and I did it.
Yeah, we did it one summer.
God, remember, it's too early.
Yeah,
what do you mean?
Thinking that.
Oh,
you have
yeah.
to get up.
To wake up. It's so early.
We were so excited to do it.
Yeah.
And then once it was time and you'd have to get up at whatever god-awful hour after being up all night trying to hook up with a girl.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It was torture.
Torture.
Really, Lowell, I think when we say we did it, I think it would be generous to say we did it no more than a week.
I feel like, you know what? I feel like we did it when we were CITs. I don't think we did it when we were counselors.
Right. I think
we did it when we were CITs. So it wasn't as bad.
Right. I think we did it
because that was like our Don and Mike years.
Exactly. Like, that's what I was going to say. That it was, I think it was the summer right after we were callers and they had us come into the studio.
Correct. And then we
then we thought we were God's gift and that we had to be the morning show at Camp Ramblewood.
Right. Because you had already been on the Don and Mike show.
Right. I mean,
and then the joke's on us because like nobody can even understand what you're saying over the speakers anyway.
Right. It was a show just for me and you, much like this podcast.
Yeah. Right.
And that will do it for the Marc and Lowell show. Please go to Facebook, go to Twitter, friend and follow us over there. And I do want to say that with all sincerity. You know what? It's 2019. We've had our 7th anniversary.
Happy birthday.
I think it's probably been years since we've encouraged people to actually share this show.
Yeah.
With one person, you have got person that's listening right now, you've got to know one person that has the same sense of humor as you that would laugh at this show. You've got to know one other person.
Yeah.
One, right?
Please, more. Help.
Just share it with them. Give them the damn link.
Help.
Just send it to them.
Just do it. Please.
Help.
And we're going to start. I'm telling you, Lowell, 2019, that's my resolution for this show. Mm-hmm. We are going to get people to start sharing this show because we've got a great,
nice core,
healthy yeah. size audience.
We do.
But I'll admit it. It hasn't grown terribly much. It grows a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's time. It's time to start spreading the word, yeah. really.
And I,
because otherwise, honestly, dude.
Yeah.
Well, how much longer, really? I mean,
I know.
Thankfully, we have sponsors. We have real sponsors. We have affiliate sponsors. We have all sorts of stuff like that. We skipped it since it's our first show of the year. But thankfully, we do make a little money, but we need to grow to keep making money.
Right.
And we appreciate all the support from all the people.
We do.
Our core crew.
That's right. So if you need that information or any other information, Marc and Lowell, just go to markandlowell.com.
And if you want to get me on all the social medias, you know where.
Hey, good evening, guys. This is almost like a Dateline story. Police tell us that it was actually surveillance video that cracked this case wide open.
Cracked.
And a special thanks to Lisa Runyon.
Bye, boys.
Oh. Wrong one. We got it.
I thought you ain't
I think
lying.
That's good.
I thought you could say I ain't lying.
Yeah, but it doesn't work. But like, keep the roar. Because
yeah, but it's got to mean something. We can't just roar for you.
It's really kind of good.
I don't know. We'll work on it. And a big shout out to Buzz Burbank, RJ Diaz, and everybody else who helps us with this show. For Lowell Melser, I'm Marc Ronick. We will see you next time on the Marc and Lowell Show.
Bye bye. You had to be a big shot, DJ. You had to open up your mouth. You had to be a big shot, DJ. All your friends were so knocked out. You had to have the last word.
Who's that? Merry Christmas,
Santa! Hi, Santa!
Oh my gosh!
Who is this?
No, Daddy, you got some presents!
Is this Reed?
Say no, it's Sloane!
Say no, it's Sloane!
Hi, Sloane! Hi!
We have to keep the phone here.
Hi, Santa!
Hi, how are you?
I just stay with my Snoopy.
Oh, you were hanging with your Snoopy?
Yes.
You want to say hi, Reed?
Hi, Steve!
Yeah!
Are you being Santa. A good boy?
Yeah! Santa!
Are you being good to your mama and your papa?
Santa!
So have you guys been good boys and girls this year?
Yeah!
Yeah? And do you think you deserve for Santa to bring you
Santa.
Some presents
tonight? Yeah!
Hold on 1 second. Rudolph has a question. Yes, Rudolph? Okay, I'll ask them. Rudolph wants to know if he can come to your house tonight, too.
Yeah!
Yeah!
I want to come!
Okay,
okay. Okay, I will tell Rudolph to come too, and I will come and I'll bring presents, and I'll leave them under the tree for you, and I will eat all the cookies.
Yay!
And then Santa's going to have a hard time getting back up the chimney because he's going to be so fat from the cookies.
Right.
Santa's just going to breathe in, go Santa. Back up the chimney, and say, Pee-wee!
Wow.
That's right. Santa loves to say Pee-wee. Can what? We all say it together? Pee-wee!
Pee-wee!
Sure, kids. Santa can stay on another hour and a half. Sure.
Yeah.
Give me a lot.